did that one over there this morning.
There we go.
There he is. 876 for the first one. $876, we ain't started yet, but I just telling Bill.
We're out waiting.
Mm-hmm. They knew I was gonna be doing it tonight.
I'll spread it out. Looks like it's more.
Who's starting this show, me or you?
You can.
Oh, I am?
You are the man, just leader in song and we'll go with it.
We'll go ahead and start.
You're ready.
I think the crowds are here. Yeah. Yeah, you're gonna have this side saying and this side saying. Yeah. We're gonna start. We're gonna start out with 876. They took this song out of a lot of song books. Matter of fact, they've taken this whole idea out of a lot of churches, haven't they?
So,
B flat man says, cable 3G.
Mercy.
can sit down and rest your bones. I tell you to shake a hand, but that would take the rest of the evening. So we'll go with what the choir is going to do. And your preacher chose this one. We, for those of you who weren't here during practice, we sang one and then we sang a bunch more just for the blessing. And he liked this one. So that's what we're going for. 360, Bill. You can sing along, you can look along, or you can just listen. 360. I think you decided it was in C, is that right?
Yeah.
Okay. I have to steal everything that I have. Unfortunately, I've not been blessed with that ability. But those songs that have been captured and preserved for us down through the years that have meant so much to someone for something they've gone through and that we can have to share. It is Well With My Soul and The Old Rugged Cross, and of course Amazing Grace.
Yes.
They are so beautiful and they still bless. I mean, what, the 1600s, the 1700s, some of those songs we still have, and yet they still work today. It's incredible, and that's the only thing that lasts that long is God.
Amen. Give the Lord a hand. Charlotte, do you have something you want to share?
My blood pressure is a little high still, but thank everybody for praying because it's nothing like it was.
Amen.
Amen. Lord,
amen. Keep praying until it gets back down to where it needs to be. Anybody else tonight? Okay. Well, it's been a good day in the Lord. I thought this morning was good. I thought today was great. I thought God is good, so that's the main thing. And anyway, we're going to go ahead and get ready for prayer then. And Serena gave her testimony for the youth this morning, and she was talking about Asbury College and all the young people that have been getting on fire for the kingdom of God. Let's pray that that revival spirit goes into all of us. Not just young, not just old, but people everywhere. Everybody needs Jesus. Everybody needs the Lord. And thank God for Asbury having that move, and pray that that move will be up on us all in all different places. So, also, I'd mention we're going to start revival today, but also revival meetings we will schedule in April for the 16th through the 19th. James Kelly Cadell that we had here before, we're pretty well got it set in stone, but I don't want to say that's total, but pretty sure that that's what we're going to do. And then on the 16th, that'll be celebrating the anniversary of North Charlestown Church of God. How many years? 68, Pat?
Yeah.
So it'll be the 68th year anniversary of North Charlestown Church of God. I think they actually started on the 10th or 11th, something like that. So, but anyway, we'll be doing that in April, or looking forward to doing that. If Satan don't throw any more goofy stuff at us, and if he does, we're just going to kick him to the back anyway. So praise God for God being good. Prayer request tonight, again, I'd mentioned Sherry Rain. She needs a miracle from God. She is with hospice at this time. I mean, she's at her home, but hospice is coming in back and forth, and her son and daughter are staying back there with her. And she needs a miracle. And Bob Goforth, have you talked to him today, Pat? Okay, he had texted me earlier about his niece wanting prayer. I'll put that on our prayer chain later. But I better not say the name because I'll read it here. Well, but anyway, I got it right here. Debbie, his niece Debbie, so needing prayer. She's got some things going on with her. So, but praying for him that these dialysis just don't drain him totally. I know that it can do that. I know he looked good here last Sunday. I know he's supposed to sing for us next Sunday, so let's pray that he'll be able to get here. I know that he'd love to do that. Still praying for ones that are having blood pressure problems, as Shirley mentioned, and also Bruce Cash had some problems with his blood pressure. Ernie Thompson, we haven't seen him for a day or two. I hope he's doing well. I need to check on him. But I know he had two or three times that he was supposed to this past week have some more things done on his knees. It wasn't knee surgery, but he was having that stuff put in there. So, yes, injection. So we need to keep him in prayer. David's still waiting to get his eye schedule done. And Mary Roberts, she's still March 9th, I think, is what hers is scheduled for. So we need to keep her in prayer. And again, all the ones that are dealing with cancer and COVID, and again, I know I say that all the time, but again, it is what it is, unfortunately. But there's a lot of people that have had heart issues and different things. Mike Hammond, still keeping him up in prayer. Travis Barrett, I know Vanessa was really heartbroken this morning. Something's going on. He needs some major prayer. And again, I know it's got to do with his heart, so we need to keep him in prayer. And still Judy Hall, Melanie Wire, Mary and Scott Young, she's still over in rehab. Pray for both of them. And then Penny Thornberry, she's taking treatments for cancer. I used to work with her over at Haas. And Gary and, what's Gary's wife's name?
Tracy.
Tracy, and I know them as well as the back of my hand. But anyway, they used to babysit for her, so I know they got to know her really well. So we certainly want to, not just because of that, but keep them in prayer. And then there's a host of others. So Violet and Eddie Vodkins, I know they've had some things going on. I know I've seen some of the, more of their family this morning, but I know they've wanted to get back in here, but she's had some issues. She's actually had to take some kind of treat or rehab or something from something she'd had done, and then her husband's had some problems. So they're wanting to get back in church, so let's keep them in prayer as well, and all these other families. So taking prayer requests from you all tonight, starting up.
Yes, it seems like it was the backs, and then it was the eyes, and now it's the blood pressure.
Yes.
My wife's cousin had one of those ridiculous blood pressures, 200 and something over something.
Oh, wow.
And rushed her to the hospital and gave her a bunch of drugs, which is what they do now, I think, and got her blood pressure down to a respectable amount and sent her home. So praying that she's going to be okay. And she does not know the Lord. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, that's one we've got to get before she escapes this earth. And this is an opportunity about talking about praying in the revival. Because Steve's right now at another church holding a service.
Amen.
And something could happen there too. So
yes.
When I say pray for the ministry, there's some going on over there.
Yes.
Borden, I think it is.
Anybody else, Wayne?
Myself, friends and family, and one unspoken, and shut in, shut outs.
Amen. Other prayer requests on down through here, Dallas?
Yes, for me and David, Schuler was really high today, so pray for me.
Okay. Dolores?
Diane, they found two spots. She has to go have a biopsy. Okay. We don't know. They haven't got a schedule yet.
Diane.
Pray that it comes back good.
And also that, what's the name of the lady that used to be a parish?
Yolinda
is what the name is. Again, I guess she's doing all right from the car wreck, but she's still got some injuries, don't she?
The last I heard, she was still in critical condition.
Oh, she is critical. Okay, I was hearing somebody back here in the back, so. Okay, I know, again, Tracy, she worked with her over there where she's at, so we certainly need to keep. Michelle, do you have your hand up?
All my family in Peoria.
Okay. Serena?
For all the youth kids' names that I mentioned this morning, for revival to continue, because it's already breaking out outside of Asbury. Also, I want to pray for the young man that came this morning. His name was Taylor, and he came up to me and Todd and said that he was glad to see other young people that were in church. So he does have a family. I don't know if they're young kids, old kids, whatever. But just pray that him and others will come, and not just to our church, but to any church, you know, with a hunger for God.
Amen. Amen. Other prayer requests? Charlie?
God's took care of my needs pretty well. I ain't got no needs at all. But we need to think about those people over there in Turkey and that earthquake.
Mm-hmm.
It's wintertime over there. Wow. It's got to be devastating.
Mm-hmm. Amen. Other prayer requests? Anybody else? Uplifted hands tonight for yourself or someone else. As we stand tonight, if you'd like to come down and be anointed for yourself or someone else, you're welcome to do that. I'll take care of that if you like. If not, we're going to have prayer tonight. If you would, take hands with each other if you like, and let's just agree in prayer here tonight. Also, Lloyd Jenkins, the gentleman that comes, a friend of ours, he had a fall this week, and he's doing well, but again, we need to lift him up in prayer. So, but anyway, well, let's agree in prayer right now. Lord, as we come to you this evening, we thank you, Lord, for allowing us to gather in this house. We thank you, Lord, for loving us, for caring for us, for being there for us always. Lord, we do lift up the needs of your children, young and old alike. Serena, give us a list of people this morning that we're to pray for. And Lord, may we continue to pray for them. Josh and Adam and Shaylin, Ava, Sammy and Tegan and Damon. Lord, we pray for them tonight, Lord. We pray for, again, these ones with blood pressure problems. For, again, Bruce Cash and Shirley Rush that's had some problems with that. And, one that David was talking about, especially for salvation, Lord. Pray for Ernie Thompson that his knees are doing better, and then God, you're going to work a miracle in his life, Lord. God, we just pray for all these needs, Lord. Again, for Penny Thornberry with her treatments, and also for Sherry Raines that needs a miracle. For Bob Goforth and that dialysis, pray for him and Patty both, as I know she's taking care of running back and forth and all the things. And we know that caretakers go through a lot also. Again, for Lloyd Bamford Jr. that had a heart procedure here a while back. It's been over a week now, but he's still got another procedure happening on the other part of the heart here soon. We pray for him as well, Lord. And again, Lord, we pray for our grandfather, Bob Shepherd. I know that my aunt had told me he was doing better after prayer Wednesday night. We pray, God, that that'll continue to stay so and be so. And we do lift up Karen Grayson tonight for healing continuously. We pray, Lord, for Travis Barrett, Lord. I know his mother was, again, heartbroken this morning and in need of prayer for him. And we just pray that you'll touch and move upon him. And that, Lord, whatever needs to take place with that heart, the numbers and everything that needs to get to where they need to be at, I pray, God, that you'd be with them in a special way, Lord. Again, for all these ones dealing with different things, we pray for each and every one, Lord. For unspoken prayer requests tonight, Lord, we pray for the one they call Yo-Yo that was in a car accident, Lord, and pray that she is doing better. And again, regardless of what we've heard or said or anything, whatever it is, I pray, God, that you'd be there for her and lift her up and intervene, Lord. For others tonight, Lord, we just pray for each and every one, for all of our families, for all of our loved ones. We pray, God, for miracle work and power, Lord. We pray for Dolores' daughter, Lord Diane, that you'll touch her, Lord, and bring forth health and well-being, Lord. And again, for all of our families, for all of our loved ones, Lord, be with each and every one of them, we pray. God, help us all to just desire more of you and less of this world on that aspect. And we just pray tonight that you'll be with us in this service here continuously. We thank you for the time thus far this day, tonight, as well as this morning. And again, we just give you praise, glory, and honor. And we do pray for the young man that was visiting with us this morning, that we'll continue to see him by staying in the congregation or staying in somewhere where he can get fed and grow closer to you, if not already doing so himself. Again, we pray that for people everywhere. We pray, Lord, for, again, the mighty work and power of God to bring forth revival in every one of our hearts, young and old alike, Lord, whether they're in college or whether they're in school or whether we're in older age or whatever. God, let there be a move of your Spirit upon all of us, that we can come together in one mind and one accord and see great things happen. We pray and ask all these things, and for a host of others we hold here on this prayer list, our prayer list of prayer book of remembrance, the names that are on it as well. And we lift up all of our loved ones right now and people everywhere in Jesus' name. And all God's children said,
amen
and amen. Praise God. You may be seated. Tom, you want to take care of the offering? Let's pray over that tonight. Father God, we just thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to give to the work of the Lord. We pray your blessings upon the offering for those who give and for those that have not to give as well. And we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, Lisa. Thank you. hand on the instruments tonight. And my mother is doing a special gift for her hand tonight.
The Lighthouse. That overlooks the sea. When I'm tossed about, you know it sends out a light, a light that I might see. And the light that shines in darkness now will safely lead me over. There was that old lighthouse, my ship would sail no more. Now everybody that lives around us, they say, why don't you tear that old lighthouse down? You know the big ships, they don't sail this way anymore. Oh, there ain't no use and it hanging around. But then my mind goes back to that stormy night when just in time, praise God, I saw the light. It was the light from that old lighthouse, and it still stands there up on the hill. And I thank God for the lighthouse. I owe my life to Him. For Jesus is the lighthouse, and from the rocks of sin,
John chapter 5 this morning. I'd like to go back there for a little while. We were I did say John 5.
John 5,
It works better when you look in John instead of Mark. Something ain't right here. But we were talking about the man that had an infirmity for 38 years and worried about getting into a pool of Bethesda and being healed. And again, he didn't have nobody to get him there, but Jesus finally asked him a question, "Will thou be made whole?" You know, that's something for all of us to think about. Will thou be whole from whatever you're going through? Jesus wants to take us through our hurts and our pains. That doesn't mean they're not going to be there. That doesn't mean problems isn't going to arise. I think we've all established that back and forth. If you just live life, you know that. But it says in verse 9, and let's pray before we read from there. Lord, we just ask you tonight that you'll bless and anoint the time that we have in your word, that your spirit will again do great things in our hearts and lives. And as the old saying is, have that own way, Lord. Have that own way.
Yes.
In Jesus' name we pray, amen. But after Jesus had told the man to rise up, take up his bed and walk, in verse 9 it says, and immediately the man was made whole. Nothing lacking, nothing left. Everything was taken care of.
Yes.
It says, he was made whole, took up his bed and walked, and on the same day was the Sabbath. And again, that's the day that you're not to do any servitor work. We know that. But who is the Lord of the Sabbath?
Oh, yeah. Amen.
Jesus Christ, isn't he?
Yes. He is.
The Jews therefore said unto him that was cured, it is the Sabbath day, it is not lawful for thee to carry thy bed. And he answered them, he that made me whole, the same said unto me, take up thy bed and walk. And these people didn't much care for Jesus anyway. They wasn't ready for the fulfillment of Scripture. They wasn't ready for the fulfillment of prophecy that had been spoken that, you know, there would one come that would be the Messiah. And they wasn't expecting Jesus Christ to be that one, because instead of coming as the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the first time he come as the Lamb of God. David was talking about that Lamb there earlier. And again, that's what we all need to understand, that Jesus is coming back.
Yes, he is.
As a Lion, but he did come the first time as a Lamb. We were talking about that in our Sunday school class this morning, and talking about Jesus. Matter of fact, we were talking about some religions that didn't really believe the right way. Now, I'm not talking about today's religion, but I'm talking about in the past, Gnosticism and Docism and Judaizers and some different things. But we got some religions just like that today in certain aspects. But they didn't believe that Jesus literally, physically came in a physical body. They believed it was like a ghost type image or something. And the problem with that is that Jesus' body was the Lamb of God. It was the thing. Mm-hmm. It was the need. It was the situation
sacrifice
that had to be sacrificed for the atonement of our sins. And, you know, we were talking about even back there in the Old Testament, Isaiah. And again, I'm thinking around 53 somewhere. But 51 to 53, it talks about it pleased the Father to bruise his Son. And again, it wasn't the fact that it pleased the Father to see his Son die, but it pleased the fulfillment of prophecy. It pleased the fulfillment of the atonement. It pleased the need for the sacrifice of sins, that I can't sacrifice enough for sins. The perfect sacrifice, the Lamb of God, was given. And again, they wasn't quite given into that yet. And a matter of fact, very few of them did by the time, well, even up to today even. It says, then asked they him, what man is that which said unto thee, take up thy bed and walk? And he that was healed knew not who it was, for Jesus had conveyed himself away, a multitude being in that place. Can you imagine somebody not knowing Jesus?
Mm-hmm.
And they just been healed by him? I wonder if that still happens today. I got a feeling there's people that get touched by the Lord and don't even know where it comes from, don't you?
Oh, yeah.
I mean, we're talking about the circle of the globe. We're not just talking about North Charles Stanton Church of God. We're talking about everywhere. There's people throughout all the countries everywhere, including America. And it says, afterward, Jesus findeth him in the temple and said unto him, behold, thou art made whole. Sin no more, lest the worst thing come unto thee. There is consequences to sin, isn't there? And again, he was letting that be made known there. I know sometimes we don't know exactly why somebody is being, something happened or this, that, and the other. I'm not the judge, but God is.
Yes.
And again, God knows that, and that's the thing that he told the man. Sin no more, lest the worst thing come unto thee. What could be worse than being crippled all your life?
Oh, I wouldn't want to think about it.
What about going to hell?
Yep.
What about not having an eternal home in heaven? I mean, I'm not saying God was going to send, you know, a leprosy on him. I wasn't saying, I don't know. But he said, go and sin no more, lest a worse thing come unto thee. I can't think of anything worse than splitting hell wide open. I can't think of anything worse than not having my name written down in the Lamb's Book of Life, praise God. And again, I think when Jesus deals with somebody for salvation, he deals with healing, but the greatest thing a person can come to is the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And every one of us need that. And the man departed and told the Jews that it was Jesus which had made him whole. And therefore did the Jews persecute Jesus and sought to slay him because he had done these things on the Sabbath day, one of their holy days. And again, I think Jesus had tried to explain to them before that the Sabbath was made for man and not man for the Sabbath, so to speak. In other words, it was a day of rest. But it's not a day for God to rest. It's a day that God has already fulfilled everything that needs to be done. But Jesus answered them, my Father worketh hitherto, and I work. Therefore the Jews sought the more to kill him, because he not only had broken the Sabbath, but said also that God was his Father. Making himself what?
Equal with God.
Equal with God. Do you all realize that Jesus is a part of the Godhead tonight?
Yeah.
I mean, you've got the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. We're Trinitarians, I guess you'd call us. We believe in the Trinity, the Father, the Son, the Holy Ghost. I know their oneness and all that. And again, they believe that Jesus is all the same thing. Regardless, again, we believe that the Father, the Son, the Holy Ghost, the three are one. We're not serving a three-headed God, but they're a part of each other, praise God. Jesus even said in John chapter 10, he said, I and my Father are one. And boy, they really got nuts on him there, but here they're pretty bad too. But it says also that God was his Father, making himself equal with God. Then answered Jesus and said unto them, verily, verily, I say unto you, the Son can do nothing of himself but what he seeth the Father do. For what things soever he doeth, these also doeth the Son likewise. For the Father loveth the Son, and showeth him all things that himself doeth. And he will show him greater works than these, that ye may marvel. For as the Father raiseth up the dead and quicketh him, even so the Son quickeneth whom he will. Makes alive. God is able to make us alive even from the grave, isn't he? For the Father judgeth no man, but hath committed all judgment unto the Son, that all men should honor the Son. Isn't that you that wasn't here this morning, but we were talking about the lyrics to a song in our hymnal. It says, this is my desire, to honor him.
To honor him.
Not to honor me or you or religiosity or beliefs, to honor God. And again, it's here he's saying, he that honoreth not the Son honoreth not the Father which has sent him. Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that heareth my word and believeth on him that sent me, doth what? Have everlasting life, and shall not come into condemnation, but is passed from death unto life. Isn't that wonderful? When we trust in Jesus, when we put our faith in him, that again, we can have everlasting life. But we got to believe what the Word of God says. We got to believe that Jesus died for our sins, and he was buried, and he rose again the third day. We got to believe that he ascended unto heaven. We got to believe that he sits at the right hand of the Father. You got to believe, I got to believe, we got to believe that when we talk to the Father in the Son's name, if you're going to talk to God, make sure you use the name of Jesus, praise God. It says, whatsoever you ask in my name, that's where we got to be at. But it says, and shall not come into condemnation. You know what that means? No more guilt. How many people have said, I don't think God could ever forgive me of what I did? And again, I'm not talking about people that are sloppy agape. I'm talking about people that are just said, you know, and I've had people tell me, and you've heard me say this before, believe they commit the unpardonable sin for this, that, and other reasons. But at the same time, if you put whatever you've dealt with in your life, you put it under the blood.
Amen.
You give it to Jesus.
The blood of Christ.
His blood cleanses us from all sins, not just some sins, but all sins.
Yes.
And if we'll believe that and trust in that, we don't have to walk around feeling guilty and not knowing. You know, the Bible says, these things are written that you may know that you have eternal life and you have eternal life in Jesus Christ your Lord. I don't have to guess or think. Some people say, well, when I die, I'll figure it out. Well, I don't want to wait that long.
No.
I'm not a good gambler. I like to know where my ducks are at in a row. I've never, you know, I'm not saying I couldn't win gambling, but I'm just saying I like to know where I stand at before I get there. And it's like, you know, I already have the promises of God.
Mm-hmm.
I have that promise and that assurance that when this life is over, because we, you know, whosoever is trusted in Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. I'm talking about in truth, spirit and truth. I'm not talking about half-heartedly or lukewarmlessly or nothing else. I'm talking about we've truly trusted in Him, laid our life down to Him. You know, I was talking about this morning, you know, the revivals and people just wanting to get closer to God. Shouldn't that be all of our desires? Shouldn't that be?
Amen.
You know, because look at what the Lord has done for you. Look what God has done for all of us. Man, I got up this morning breathing. How about you? I got up, was able to walk and talk, and you know, I was able to put on shoes. You know, I know we talk about if it don't hurt, it don't work, but glory to God, it still works somewhat, don't it? Glory to God, regardless of how old or how young we are. Again, we're thankful for the God that, you know, your blood pressures and stuff, at least, you know, you're not having a stroke or nothing right now. And others that have had heart problems and different things, had lung removed, different things that have happened to people. You know, God has been good to us, hasn't He?
Yes.
God is keeping us going. Dave, you've had some, what was it, you had cancer issues.
I did.
A couple times. And it's like others of you have had things going in your life too. And God has been good to you.
Amen.
God has been good to all of us, praise God. So again, to walk around and say, God, you know, when we're talking about condemnation, we're talking about guilt because of things I've done, not because of things I'm doing. If you continue in sin, God forbid, you need to know that also. But at the same time, if I've given it to Jesus, I don't have to walk around guilty about what I've done. You know, people may condemn me. People may put me down for something I've done or something. You know, I had a group of people that didn't much care when I come to Christ. You know, they always saying, you know, this is what you did, that's what you've done. Most of them I don't even see or hear from much anymore. It's been a long time. But nonetheless, it didn't matter what other people say about you. It didn't matter what other people have done or thought about you. Glory to God. If Jesus thinks you're saved, that's all that matters, isn't it? And the thing that He says, if you'll believe in Me and you'll trust in Me and believe that I come from the Father and that we're one, you've got it made, folks. I'm not talking about made to go out and play around with sin. I'm talking about you've got a made to know that you've got a home in heaven, that you've got your life hid with Him. It says, going on here, it says, man, what verse did I just read? I know I was trying to find that same one. What was it?
You read 24.
24. 25 then, condemnation, that's what I was looking at. Verse 25, verily, verily, I say unto you, the hour is coming and now is. What?
Right.
When the dead shall hear the voice of the Son of God, and they that hear shall live.
Amen.
Man, He's going to shout so loud one of these days, our family's going to come up out of the grave, Lord God. And if you're in there, you're going to come out with them too. But at the same time, and again, I know this is pre-cross, but at the same time, I know that there were people come up at that time. But He's also, we talked about Thessalonians here recently this past week. But at the same time, He's coming back one of these days for us, praise God. He's coming back for those bodies that are still in the grave. He's coming back to change our bodies if we're still here from corrupt to incorrupt, immortal, or mortal to immortal, praise God. But it says, for as the Father hath life in Himself, so hath He given to the Son to have life in Himself, and hath given Him authority to execute judgment also, because He is the Son of Man. Marvel not at this, for the hour is coming in the which all that are in the grave shall hear His voice and shall come forth, they that have done good into the resurrection of life, and they that have done evil unto the resurrection of damnation. Boy, we hate to hear that, but that is, again, a real deal, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
And again, how can I do right and how can I do evil? Whatsoever is not of God is sin. Whatsoever is not of faith is sin, I should say. But faith is in God, isn't it? Faith is trusting Him with everything I got. You know, and that's a part of everyday life if we're Christians. But it says, I can't of my own self do nothing. As I hear, I judge. And my judgment is just because I seek not my own will, but the will of the Father which has sent me. If I bear witness of myself, my witness is not true. There is another that beareth witness of me, and I know that that witness which he witnesses of me is true. Ye sent unto John, and he bare witness unto the truth. But I received not testimony from man. But these things I say, that what?
You might be saved.
That might's kind of a scary word sometimes. Because you have to accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior.
You do.
Our loved ones that are not saved have to accept. I can't get them on my coat string, can you?
No.
I'd like to, wouldn't you?
Yeah,
I'd like to tie a rope for them and jerk them on into heaven, glory to God, when I go. But at the same time, they're going to have a relationship with God. They're going to have to be a part of that. You know, one man said, there's no grandchildren in heaven. There's no uncles or aunts or nieces. There's only two things, sons and daughters. I mean, there's not even a second or third cousin. I mean, it's got to be the whole thing or no thing. It's got to be you're either in or out, praise God. It says, he was a burning and shining light, and you were witness for a season to rejoice in his light. But I have greater witness than that of John, talking about John the Baptist. For the works which the Father hath given me to finish, the same works that I do bear witness of me, that the Father hath sent me. And the Father himself which hath sent me hath borne witness of me. Ye have neither heard his voice at any time nor seen his shape. And ye have not his word abiding you. For whom he has sent, him ye believe not. Again, those Pharisees was not taking him at his word. Remember, they were more worried about the Sabbath and all those things, trying to break it, not taking his word. And verse 39 is a scripture you might want to highlight sometime. It says, search the scripture. For in them ye think you have eternal life, and they are they which testify of me. The scripture says, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. The scripture says, there's no other name under heaven than in the name of Jesus that no man can be saved. The Bible tells us that we're to trust in the Lord with all our heart. The Bible tells us that we're to come and believe that God has raised His Son from the dead. The Bible tells us that we'll confess with our mouth and believe in our heart that God has raised Him from the dead. Thou shall be saved. Again, search the scriptures.
Yes.
For in them ye think you have eternal life, and they are they which testify me. And ye will not come to me that ye might have life. I receive not honor from man. Who does Jesus receive honor from? His Father in heaven, praise God. He was trying to get honor, but they wouldn't. But anyway, it says, but I know you that you have not the love of God in you. Wow. Does people know that we have the love of God in us? We need to let the love show through us. Love has to do, as I've shared this, as I was shared many times, love has to do with how you treat people, not how you feel about people. And again, the best I can tell you, I'm not going to feel good about everybody, and neither are you. There's going to be some people you want to run away from. There's going to be some people you just soon never get around sometimes. But there's going to be, everybody needs to know that God has done us right, and we want to do people right too.
Amen.
Regardless if they treat us like a piece of trash. Regardless, you know, if I remember right, Jesus was spit upon. His beard was plucked. He was beaten with a cat of nine tails. All those things. And yet, when he was on the cross, again, I know we were on his mind. But at the same time, he still said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. How many people out here in the world don't have a clue what they're doing? They can't have. Not with the stuff that they're doing today. They can't have a godly clue in their mind. I mean, they can kill and do these things and hurt their own families and own people in their own lives. And, you know, the slaying and all the stuff. Every time you turn on the TV, something's going on. You don't have to go that far. It isn't the 20 miles. You say, well, that's get you into Louisville, right? You don't even have to go 20 miles. You don't have to go 10 or 5 miles. There's stuff going on all around us, isn't there?
Yeah.
I mean, people have been killed in all of our areas, regardless of where you live. Crazy things have happened. And again, we realize that we're living in the last day.
We are.
And we need to be ready at all times. But we also, while we're ready, we need to be that light to a lost and dying world. We need to be that salt of the earth. We need to share that love of God that's in us. I want you to turn with me, if you will, for a little while, to Matthew's Gospel also. Matthew's Gospel, chapter 5 tonight. Going back to the Beatitudes a little bit. But I'm not going to read through the 5th chapter. I want to get to the end of the 5th chapter. Matthew's Gospel, the 5th chapter. Chapter 5, verse 43. Oh, here we go again. Something about that word love, isn't it? There's a lot of four-letter words that are no good, isn't there? But that's one that's great, ain't it? But Matthew 5, 43, it says, "You have heard that it has been said, thou shalt love thy neighbor and hate thy enemy." That's the easiest way to do it, isn't it?
It is easy.
Man, if they treat me good, I'm going to treat them good. If they treat me like dirt, I don't want nothing to do with them. But that's not what Jesus said, is it?
No.
And don't get me wrong, because I know that there's people that are hard to love sometimes. I know that there's, you know, again, I'm not saying this is anything you can do within yourself sometimes. It's easy to love people that love you. It's easy to love people that are part of your life and everything like that. But what about that person that's rotten as all get out? That person that would do anything to hurt you and hurt your family or anything? It's hard to love them. And I'm not telling you that you got to be some kind of carpet for them to walk over. But at the same time, you do have to treat them as best you can with the love of God. But it tells us, "But I say unto you, love your enemies, bless them that curse you, do good to them that hate you, and pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you." Man, there's people in other countries that like to see every person that calls herself a Christian dead. Do you know that? There's people in this country too. I mean, I know there's Satan worship and everything else. I know there's wicked. I know there's other things. I know there's things that go on all the time that don't want nothing to do with Christ. And we could sit here and talk bad about them and jump all over them. And again, we're not going to lie about what they believe, but at the same time, it tells us that we're first of all to pray for them. There's a lot of praying that we need to be doing. You know, we need to pray for those in authority. We all don't like everybody in government, do we? But we still got to pray for them, don't we? Amen. We got to lift them up in prayer. God knows they need it. I mean,
You know.
Again, I'm not going to doubt that. They need saved, they need healed, they need delivered. Whatever it is, and I'm not going to say what party or denomination, that has nothing to do with it. It has to do with people being evil, people being lost and needing to be saved. But it says, "Pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you, that ye may be the children of your Father which is in heaven." Remember I said there's no uncles and aunts and nephews. It says children, don't it? It says that ye may be the children of your Father which is in heaven. For he maketh, his sun to rise on the evil and on the good, and sendeth rain on the just and on the unjust. That's why bad things happen to good people. You know, we get the idea, well, I'm a Christian, so I should never have problems. Shouldn't ever anything bad happen to me. Folks, it's going to happen bad to you whether you're a Christian or not. The good thing about it is I've got somebody on my side. I've got somebody to help me when a trial comes through. I have somebody to carry me through when I don't know how to get through anymore. I have somebody to lift me up when I'm down and try to keep me from staying that way, praise God. But it says, as we said earlier, "For if you love them which love you, what reward have you? Do not even the publicans the same?" Talking about the tax collectors. "And if you salute your brethren only, what do you more than others do? Do not even the publicans so?" They didn't have much about politicians back then either, did they? But nonetheless. "Be ye therefore perfect." That word perfect means mature or complete. There's not a one of us in here that's sinless perfected tonight. What I mean, and when I say sinless perfected, I mean that you cannot sin. You're not supposed to sin, but as long as we're in this mortal body, you have the ability to do that. You have to choose every day what you're going to do. You have to make a Christian decision. You have to be led by the Holy Spirit. Because if we wasn't, every day Satan is throwing stuff in our face, isn't he? Every day he's tempting us, trying to get us. And you know what? If you fall into that, it just gets easier and easier as you do it. Have you played around with sin? Sin will play around with you. And that's why we got to get, again, back to being closer to God. But that, when he's talking about perfect, he's talking about mature or complete. I'm mature or complete because I'm trusting in Jesus. I'm trusting in God. I'm believing that God can get me through it.
Praise God.
And I'm going to trust that till the day I leave this old earth. How about you? Mm-hmm. And then we'll have eternity to know so, won't we?
That's right.
It won't just be faith. It'll be right in our face at that time. We'll be known as we're known, and we'll see him face to face. Read on into the chapter 6 here. It says, take heed or beware that you do not your alms, your gift giving, we could say, before man to be seen of them. Otherwise you have no reward of your Father which is in heaven. Therefore, when thou dost that alms, do not sound a trumpet before thee as the hypocrites do in the synagogues. A hypocrite is somebody that's a pretender. Somebody that makes believe. We've talked about that. There's a lot of people that play church. There's a lot of people that play religiosity. And they need to get the real deal, folks. They need to get on fire for God. And again, when it says, if you're doing almsgiving, if you're giving gifts just to get people to see you. And they did that. I mean, my goodness, they would take a trumpet and blow it just so you could see them throw a penny in some beggar's hand or what, in their bucket or whatever. And that way, you know what you'd do? You'd pat them on the back and say, look how good you are. Mm-hmm. You know, if it may be in here also, as we read here, I don't know how far we'll get here tonight, but the Bible tells us, well, I think it has to do with fasting, we're not to let our right hand know what our left hand does. That doesn't mean you can't ever say you did something as a testimony. But if I just tell you something that I did to brag about myself, oh, please give me glory. Please give me honor. Remember what we said about this morning service? This is my desire to honor you, Lord. That's what we need to be looking for. Nothing wrong with a testimony and giving God the glory, but make sure it's God's glory. We don't need to sound our trumpet to say, you know, look what I've done, this, that, and the other. Again, testify of God using things, but make sure that it's His glory and not ours in that sense. I'm not saying never to praise anybody, but I hope most of you know what I'm talking about. But it says, and again, this is what I just said, but when thou doest alms, it is in this part too, let not the left hand know what thy right hand doeth, that thy alms may be in secret, and thy Father which seeth in secret himself shall reward thee openly. My God will supply all my needs according to His riches and glory. And you can say that to yourself too. If you're a child of God, He's going to take care of you. You say, well, I don't have $1 million in the bank, and I don't have a million food store. You know, the house is not as big as, you know, Cape Canaveral. So, I mean, I don't have these things that are this mansionable and all that stuff. But one thing I do got is I've got faith in God. I think most of us could sing that one song. I've got food on my table. I've got shoes on my feet.
Yeah.
I mean, all of us, I think, pretty, you know, I don't think any of us probably don't have closets that are probably overpacked. I know I could dump mine out a little bit. How about you tonight? I've got more than I need is what I'm trying to say. And it says, and when thou prayest, thou shalt not be as the hypocrites are, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues and in the corners. I don't know that we have that problem anymore. It's hard to get people to pray in public, period, anymore. We need to be. But in their point of view, they did as a religious sector anyway. But it says, be not as the hypocrites are, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues and in the corners of the street, that they may be seen of men. Verily I say unto you, they have their reward. But when thou prayest, and we went over this here a while back, I'm not going to go through all the edicts of it, but it says, but thou, when thou prayest, enter into thy closet, and when thou hast shut the door, pray to thy Father which is in secret, and the Father which seeth in secret shall reward thee openly. Isn't that wonderful? But when you pray, use not vain repetition as the heathen do, for they think that they shall be heard for their much speaking. And again, he gives us the Lord's Prayer there. You know, I've been around people that they believe that you ought to pray for 2 or 3 hours every morning. That's fine if you can. If you got a job, sometimes that's hard to do. If you got things that you got to do, that's sometimes hard to do. I got to tell you, I'd rather see somebody praying for 5 minutes sincere than somebody just trying to get their clock watched.
Oh, yes. Mm-hmm.
I mean, I've tried to pray for a long period of time before, and you know what happens after a while? You end up falling asleep. you get tired. You know that. And I'm not saying it's bad if the people are sincere. But I'm saying, you know, make sure that's what we are when we're praying, that we're sincere. Quit worrying about measuring the time, as some would tell you. And again, that's fine. I know people say, you know, couldn't you pray with him for an hour? If that's what you can do, do it. But I'd rather see you pray for 5 minutes or 10 minutes or 20 minutes than not pray at all. And mean it from your heart, praise God. Yeah. I know there's some people that, you know, they pray a lot. They pray all day through, and their heart's in it. I'm not opposed to that. They're great with that. They're prayer warriors. Matter of fact, I think they've even been called that in a great way. But anyway, it says, after this manner, therefore, pray ye. Again, verse 9, our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. For if ye forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. Man, that's great, ain't it? But, there's another verse there. But if you forgive not men their trespasses, neither will your heavenly Father forgive your trespasses. That's pretty serious, isn't it? I need to make sure that I don't hold debt or trespasses against other people. Should I? Even people that, you know, I've even talked to people that have been divorced and spouses and stuff like that. You know, I know you can get pretty aggravated and frustrated with each other with that. But at the same time, give it to God. If I hold unforgiveness against somebody else, I'm actually holding it against myself, what I'm doing. Because, as I've said to other people, all you do is think about that person that you're hateful or strifeful with. You're thinking about that person that owes you money. You're thinking about that person that done you wrong song and all that stuff. So again, give it over to God. I'll tell you how to keep from doing that. Don't loan money to nobody unless you can give it away. I mean, that's what I've told my sons before. I said, you know, if you can't afford to give it away, don't do it. You know, loan them, that's fine. But if they don't give it back to you, I'm talking about money now. If they don't give it back to you, don't be expecting it. I mean, yes, if I've loaned somebody in something good faith, but at the same time, don't do it with the expectation of. And some people want it with usury, the Bible called it, which is interest. I want to get something out of it. But do what you do with the love of God. You know, the Bible says, he that giveth to the poor lendeth to the Lord. I think we mentioned that the other night. And the Lord payeth with great dividends. Praise God. Proverbs mentions that. But anyway, that's another scenario there. But again, I mentioned money because that's usually the thing I hear more about anything. And sometimes it's even at grave sites. You know, with that person, this, that, or the other. And they're wanting forgiveness then. And the problem is that person's not there no more. They're not there to say anything to them, good or bad, anymore. Moreover, when you fast, it didn't say if you fast, but when you fast. Moreover, when you fast, be not as the hypocrites. And folks, I'm not one of those persons that's going to, again, put a legal thing about fasting. But if you can, try to fast sometimes. Put it on your heart. And again, fasting has to do with afflicting your soul. That means I put other things out of my heart and my mind so I can spend more time thinking about God and Christ. If you need to desire to do this, sometimes read out of Isaiah 58. It talks about a real fast. I'm not fasting to tie God's hands together. I'm not fasting to make God do evil for me. I'm fasting because I want to set myself aside for God to work in me. And I hope that's all of our desire. You know, if we're wanting to see revival, that's not a bad thing. But, you know, if you don't fast, pray. Pray and believe either way. Both of them are good. But fasting means setting something aside that you can give that over to God and spend time with Him. You know, if you're not eating, you're not going to want to think about food, are you? If you're not messing with that computer, you're not going to want to be thinking about, you know, there's other things you can fast from. I know that too, but I know biblical fasting is usually food and water, and it can't be water all the time because you'll die a lot quicker without water than you will food. That's just common sense. But anyway, going in here, it says, And moreover, when you fast, be not as the hypocrites of a sad countenance, for they disfigure their face, that they may appear unto man to fast. Verily I say unto you, they have their reward. But thou, when thou fastest, anoint thy head, wash thy face, that thou appear not unto man to fast, but unto the Father which is in secret. And here we go again. And the Father which seeth in secret shall reward thee openly. Lay not up for yourselves treasures upon earth, where moth and rust doth corrupt, and where thieves break through and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust doth corrupt, and where thieves do not break through nor steal. The world didn't give it, and the world can't take it away. Praise God. It come from God, and you can't take it away from it. It come from the Holy Spirit, and there's nothing you can do about it. I'm saved, and I'm set apart, and I don't care what the world thinks about it. I'm going on with Jesus. How about you tonight?
Amen.
And the world may not like it, and they may not like our attitude or our positions in this, that, or the other. Again, like I said, you don't have to be a carpet to walk over for people, but at the same time, we do want to love people, but I don't got to give into their junk, do I? Neither do you. There's things I don't agree with people, and I'm not going to give in to it. And you have to decide that too. It's easily done, but at the same time, it's easier done if you know Jesus Christ to help you not worry about it, not to think about it. Praise God. Verse 21, just to read, for where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. Where is our treasures at tonight?
Praise God.
Where is our heart at tonight? Will you stand with me tonight? We're not going to stay here long tonight. I believe it's been a good day in the Lord. I believe all of us is wanting to see a great move of the Lord in our lives and in the lives of others. You know, we've been talking about revival today. And like I said, let's let revival begin now. I mean, let's let it begin. And it has to begin in me. It has to begin in you. All of us have to have a desire. I mentioned a song, this is my desire to honor Him. But in honoring Him, I want to do things that He would want us to do. How about you? And I'm not just talking about me, but all of us as a body of Christ. Do you love the Lord tonight?
Yes. Amen.
Are you going to serve Him with everything you got tonight?
Yes, sir.
Amen. How about tomorrow? It's got to be 7:24, don't it? So let's believe that. But anyway, let's close in prayer tonight. Father God, we just thank You for allowing us to be here tonight. We thank You for the time that we've had. We thank You, Lord, for loving us, Lord, even when we were unlovable. And we thank You, Lord, for allowing us to, again, be what You want us to be. And help us to do that. Forgive us where we fail You, and help us to seek more of You and less of this world. I pray, God, as we desire to see a move of the Spirit in our church congregation, I pray that others do the same. Be with us as we go to our homes or wherever we travel at tonight. Be with all of us and bring us back safely when opportunity comes. We ask it all in Jesus' name, and all God's children said,
Amen.
Amen. God bless you. Come back and be with us Wednesday night if you can. Have a good evening. The Lord God bless you.